episode of Last on the Brakes, the MotoGP podcast. And as you can all see, if you're joining us visually, if not, audio guys, it is Lucio Ceccanello. I was kind of wondering what to give you as your title, because your LCR...
Let's
man
say,
of everything.
team principal,
team manager, team owner, founder, everything.
I always joke with the people saying I am the one who pays the invoices.
Exactly. So the invoice payer from LCR Honda.
Yeah.
So Lucio, thank you very much for joining us on this beautiful hot Brewery Ram Thursday.
Thank you for the invitation.
Always welcome. We love you. So last time we had you on the podcast, we talked a little bit about you. I want to give the opportunity to plug that. If people haven't listened to that, they should go back and learn a bit more about your story as a rider and the beginnings of the team. That photo that you have in your office, love that. But this week, obviously, you're quite in the headlines already, especially given the race winner of the Phillip Island Grand Prix race on a historic Saturday. But first, of course, also some worse news for you guys last time out in Australia. After a fairly impressive return for Alex Rins, now it seems like he's got to have another small surgery and won't be with you guys this weekend. So let's start there, because it's also nice to check. How is Alex? Is he okay? And what are you thinking for his return and our new recovery?
Okay, Alex, in a couple of hours this morning, he will have a small surgery. Basically, as far as I understood from what he told me, he has a small hernia on his around the fracture on the fibula that compresses some muscle and it creates some kind of compartmental syndrome. And basically, the
so
surgery,
that's like arm pump, right?
Correct,
but this
correct.
Time, obviously, but it's his leg that's affected.
Correct. But basically, the surgery is very simple, because basically they will just remove the hernia, and then everything should be okay. But of course, he realized in racing in Indonesia, and then also during the practice on Friday in Australia, that the pain was higher and higher, and. Then we decided to go to Melbourne to have an MRI and a CT scan, and then has been confirmed that everything from the point of view of the bone of the heel of the fracture, everything is on the good path, but he has this small problem. So,
well, that's some good news then. That it's not the fracture and that seems to be healing as it should. But he put in still some really impressive performances after he'd returned. And obviously he won that incredible race for you guys in COTA as well. And it's just, I don't know, it's a bit of a roller coaster season, both for him and for you guys. But let's talk about Alex then, as we wait for him to come back. Talk to us about that COTA win. Because that was...
That was
I mean,
something.
You guys sometimes just turn up and you're just like, no, this is an LCR weekend. We've seen you have success before, well, but how special was that?
What was amazing. We didn't expect, you know, a such great performance. We knew that Alex was quite happy with the bike. He never complained a lot about the bike. He always... spend the kind of nice words, you know, with how the bike have to be ridden. And of course, he told us weak points, and he told us that he would like to improve a certain area and so on. But something magic happened in that race, in that racetrack. I think that is a combination to the fact that he really loves his racetracks, especially in the first part of the racetrack, where there are a lot of fast consecutive corners, a lot of fast chicanes. He has some really special trajectory that he made a difference, like around 3/10 faster than everybody, you know. And then the fact that the layout, the circuit is, yes, there are some tight corners, but in reality, there aren't tight, because the circuit is very large. It's very large, so the average of the speed is still high. So all that combined made made it possible, you know. And then he did an excellent job already on Saturday, finished second on the sprint, and then...
Is that when you started to kind of think, oh, maybe...
Yeah, absolutely, absolutely. Already from Saturday qualifying, you know. And then we said, okay, wow, the sprint was a confirmation, and then... The race, he always attacked, you know, even in the last laps. And I don't know if you remember, it was like, you know, he had the kind of more than 2 seconds of advantage. And then in the last lap, he said, slow down, because, you know, he was braking, lifting please, the rear tire please. And moving the bike, you know, like he would wanted to beat his record lap, you know, so...
Well, it was obviously a very special moment then for the team again. One you've lived before with different riders as well, but an awesome start to the season. You said, like, Alex, obviously, he's incredibly talented. We know that already, but he's very precise as well, isn't it? Isn't he, rather? How helpful has he been coming into your team and your project and having completely different feedback, I imagine, coming from an inline four to the Honda? Has it been interesting to kind of work with him and see his perspective?
Yeah, as far I know, both riders, Alex and Johan Mir, made similar comments about, you know, let's say their feeling on Honda's bike, and they gave some very interesting information to the engineers. And And then I think that information was very helpful to realize that perhaps we found riders, two different riders, that they wanted to have less electronic filter between the throttle and the outcome of the power from on the rear tire. So they wanted to have more direct, what they call more direct feeling, what they ask from the throttle and what is the output of the power. And and then they, of course, started to understand that is a bike that need a kind of a V style. So let's say that you need to pick up the bike as soon as possible, like, you know, Dani Pedrosa, Casey Stoner, and also, of course, in the last decade, Marc Márquez. You know, the fact that the style of pick-upping the bike, it's very, very important, you know, to use all the potential of the Honda in acceleration.
Okay, well, that's very interesting. I don't know if anyone's ever said specifically what it is that they've said, obviously both arriving from the same machine to the same machine, but... Now as well then, we've got to talk about Joan Zarco, who will be your new rider on the block next season. Pretty incredible for you guys, having already done this deal, and then he finally takes that maiden win. Obviously been a rider taking podiums, pole positions, right at the top in MotoGP for some time, but was just missing that glorious final top step. How did that make you feel when it must be quite strange, because you know he's coming to you, but right now they're pure competition for you guys.
Yeah, definitely, yes. But the fact that Johan could realize, let's say, an important dream, an important, could make, you know, a victory that was missed in his, a victory MotoGP that was missed in his career, we all was very pleased, you know, because also we know that when a rider get a victory, it's like, you know, even when they get a podium, when they start to get the first podium and they get the first victory, I believe that something special happened, let in term of the increase of your self-esteem and the increase of your knowledge that it can be done. You can make it, you know. So it helped definitely to be more motivated to pursue this and repeat this kind of achievable goal, you know?
I guess you mean like unconsciously, no? Because no rider is walking around thinking, oh, I can't do this.
Yeah.
But that real true confirmation, I have done this, so I know I can do it again.
That's it.
Is that something you experienced as well?
Oh, absolutely, absolutely.
Because I guess that's one part of the perspective that some of the guys up and down the grid, managing teams, owning teams, don't quite have the same as you. You have the rider's perspective, like you said.
Well, I race in the smaller category. I was a professional rider in this smaller category, so I wasn't a MotoGP rider. But basically, the what happened, you know, during a sport career, during a racing career, is pretty the same. You know, you figure out that you want to achieve a certain goal. You know. Until, you know, the moment that you are able to get it, you know, you always deep in your soul, you know that it's extremely difficult. And then when you do it, you know, it's something special because you go back on track. And then the next week, you know, you go back on track and say, I made it, you know. You feel like everybody else needed to respect more, you know. Yourself because they, you know, you beat all of them, you know. So it's a nice feeling, and it's a kind of sport where you need to have an incredible self-esteem. You need to have need to be very
true, pure confidence.
Correct, true pure confidence, and you need to be convinced, you know, that you can make it. And definitely, we were all very pleased because we knew that we were happy for him, and second, we know that this eventually can help him to come in our team next year and say, hey, I'm a winning rider. I'm a MotoGP winning rider. I need this, and perhaps can be also even more. Listen on its own opinion, you know.
Well, talking about Joan, then we're talking like we know he's definitely coming to you. You confirmed, I think, a couple of weeks ago, that he was definitely coming to you. Has that changed at all? Because we still have now we have a whole new set of rumors about Honda seats, riders, the future. From your team's perspective, you're definitely welcoming Zarco next year, and he'll ride alongside Taka, right?
Yes, I mean the situation was for us quite clear. I mean, when we signed together with HRC Zarco, we started to set up a project. You know, we announced to everybody that this is our project. We announced to our sponsor, and we started to sign contract with our sponsor. So. Let's say that, of course, the rider manager and the rider himself were like, that can be interesting, this place, you know. But then, due to the fact that Honda respected the engagement that we all have made, and also due to the fact that with Zarco, Johan want to have a 2 years program flat out with you know, same group of engineers, same group of technicians and people. And in MotoGP nowadays, if you really want to achieve good results, I believe that you need to have at the moment you need to have an experienced MotoGP rider with very high talent. But as well, you need to have a stability, because it's very rare that a rider, even with experience, come and then immediately bang, is going to be massively competitive, because the competitiveness of the class is so high that you really need you know, to work on every single details, every single race, every single days, and then per years, per couple of years, and then finally you can, you know, you can get, you can go, you can make special results, yeah.
Well, I mean, you say that, but Alex did it quite quickly.
he did quite quickly, enormous talent, but don't forget that we struggled until then, and also we struggle after.
Yeah, no,
we struggle
sure.
in
it was one of those magical moments, wasn't it, where everything came together?
Because we struggle in Jerez. We arrive in Jerez after having winning the Grand Prix, the Americas Grand Prix, and then in Jerez was difficult to stay in the top 15, you know. And then also we struggle quite a bit in French. Then let's say that we knew that in Mugello it could do better, because Mugello is a very, very fast racetrack, very flow, and perhaps where we suffer more, Alex and our bike, was more on the stop-and-go corner and the tight corner, you know, typical corner of turn 2 and 3 of Jerez, and some corner in Le Mans. But we knew that in Mugello was like more, the average of the speed was more high, and then we could eventually make good results. But unfortunately, Mugello, he performed quite well on Friday. He finished P3 on Friday during the practice, and then during the sprint he had this crash, and our season, unfortunately, since then has been really tough.
It has, but I mean, on the other side of the garage though, with Taka, when there was, I mean, in the middle of the season, I don't know, probably from around that time and certainly into the summer, Honda, Marc Marquez, everything dominating the headlines. Taka was just quietly taking points most weekends, and not one point, a few points, and really homing in on the top 10. His experience now, it's an interesting mix that you've got now with Alex, obviously, once he's back, hopefully, with Taka's experience of the Honda. And it'll be an interesting mix you'll have next year as well, with a rider who in Joanna's ridden the Yamaha, KTM, Ducati, and now comes to the Honda. Taka's, I don't know, I always feel Taka's a little underrated at times, because he just quietly takes some points and...
I want to say that ideally and logically, I believe that, we should also look for time to time for young rider generation, because they have a kind of newer riding style, they have more open mind, and they eventually take a little bit more risks, you know. And then this, in our sport, is also sometimes very important to take some risk. But in our historical moment, we all together inside with on the managers, we decide that our priority is to close the technical gap with the best competitor in the world. And to make it is necessary, we need the full commitment of Honda, which they are already, they are doing really massively. But also we need experienced riders. That's why we decided to move with a talent, experienced rider like Johan Zarco. But as well, Honda figured out that Taka is the sole Honda rider that since 2018 is competing on the RCV machine, and he know every single year, every single let's say, you know the bike of every single years, and you know the plus and the minus of every RCV project through the years, and then he also speak the same language of the Honda engineers. So Honda decided to continue with Taka, and I believe, and we cannot say no, that Taka is a fast rider. Perhaps is a rider that needs to improve his performance under pressure. So if you look, for instance, when there is let's say the qualifying, is going in an attack mood, but perhaps he would need a couple of more laps, you know. But when he's relaxed, he's super fast. If you look, is the average of his performance of the warm-up on Sunday morning, they are totally amazing, you know. They are really, really hilarious, you know. Imagine that in 2020, that was actually the best season of TAC in terms of result, he made many times the fastest, he was many times the fastest rider in the warm-up as well. And we made the kind of the world, kind of world championship ranking based on the warm-up results, and he would have finished second. You know? So
just needs to bring that back again a few hours later.
Yeah, and then we say, and then we saw that in the race, let's say that he reached his best lap time after four or five laps later than the other riders. So it looks like we really appreciate how he's able to go fast. We need to still to continue to work with him on letting him go fast under pressure, under the, let's say, under the battling mood as well.
Okay, well, we'll see then. That's interesting because, yeah, I mean, we love Tacker as well, so we'll see what he can do. Warm-up champion. It's very cool, but...
Vice champion, sorry,
yeah. But, okay, well, that's an interesting perspective from your guys, like, working with him. And like you say, he will be next season as well, the only rider who's been on the Honda for a long, long time and seen all the kind of the steps that you've made or directions that have been taken. So, yeah, always an interesting one. But talking about, like you said, like, we took the decision together with HRC, together with Honda. Your team is a true independent team. You obviously work with Honda, you have Honda machinery, but how does it work for you? Because I think it's an interesting thing for fans to get to know a little bit. For your team, what is your relationship like with Honda and how does it work together?
The relationship has been developed during the years. Just taking consideration that when we started in MotoGP class with Honda was 2006. So, since the last 18 MotoGP season, you know, we are with Honda. So it's quite normal that after so many years, the relationship is evolving, is developing. And if you look, when we started with Casey Stoner in 2006.
Oh yeah, of course, you started with the wonder.
Yeah, that's a phenomenon. When we started with Casey, then also with Carlos Checa, and then after with Randy Depugnet for a few years, you know, and then also with Stefan Bradl. Let's say that until Randy Depugnet years, we always had the previous year machine. Like Ducati is giving at the moment to VR46, to Gresini, it's a previous year machine. Then, from the 2012, when Bradl joined as a Moto2 world champion our team, we started to have the current year machine, but we didn't really get the evolution parts during the season. Then when Carl arrived, because Carl performed quite well, getting podiums, you know, and then winning races, then Honda increased their commitment with us. So basically, not only the current year machine, but also they deliver the evolution parts to us. They deliver the evolution parts, let's say, a couple of weeks later, when they knew and they were sure that the evolution part were confirmed as a step forward for the motorbike performance.
That's almost a dream, isn't it? You yeah. get it when you know it's going to work.
but lately, I must say that the latest evolution of the relationship with Honda is that Honda is now, since a couple of years, and especially lately, producing more evolution parts, and some evolution parts are given to the factory team, and some evolution parts are given to us, and then we swap. So basically, we have the latest motorbike specification with the latest evolution parts, and as well, we are part of the program for developing the bike, so testing new parts. Sometimes we test the new part first, then the factory team. Sometimes we test different part of the factory team and then we swap. Sometimes we test the parts after the factory team.
And so how is that relationship from your point of view? It must be something quite positive and special to be working that closely together now, especially because we've seen, like, with Aprilia now adding a satellite team and seeing the real value of that. Obviously Ducati, 8 machines, bit of a different situation with the, I don't want to say 4 KTMs, the 4 RC16s as well. There's a lot more data. Is it, how is it from your perspective, like you said, starting from with Casey, with Honda, and just getting like, okay, it's last year's bike, thank you very much, yes, we'll have that, let's go racing. It must be a different world now from the team perspective to be part of that as a project rather than just as a team.
We feel part of Honda and we feel really motivated to give as far we can our support to let Honda claim back the ranking and then catch victories.
I like how you say claim it back, because I think it feels like people have very short memories in the sport sometimes. But are you confident then, being in the middle, that we're going to start seeing them claiming it back and see the
Absolutely.
Kind of progress? Because we saw a few recently, and obviously this season you already won, thanks to Alex in COTA. But then it was a tougher last couple of weekends, maybe. Yeah. But do you, from what you see on the inside, are you happy with where the future is going to take you all?
Definitely, we have to separate what we actually are using on track and what will be the material that we will test in Valencia. Because as you know, with the actual technical rule, we basically cannot change engine specification, we basically cannot change more than 2 aerodynamic package. So we are a little bit limited. That's fair, that is the rule, and we stick with the rule. But I am definitely happy because there are a lot of material that has been made and is still under construction in HRC that, you know, we are quite impressed to have seen such a big move forward. And perhaps, you know, not everything will be wow, but the fact that we will have a lot of parts to test and different spec of chassis, different spec of engines, different spec of aerodynamic package. You know, we are very excited and confident that we will definitely make a step forward, which doesn't mean yes we are going to have the best bike in the grid, but definitely we are looking and working for making a step forward.
Okay, well, it sounds like exciting times for you guys. And do we take that then as you being happy with Honda? Because we know the Austrians were very keen to add more machinery. It's been interesting to see all of the responses from different independent teams. I think you already signed up before that became sort of a talking point. But how do you see the future of the team? Is it with Honda, or are you happy with the dynamic you have now? You like working that closely with a factory to kind of make those results?
Of course, never say never, but I want to say that since I was a child, I had a lot of admiration and passion for all Honda motorbikes. My first bike was an Honda, my first race was on a Honda, my first victory as a rider was on a Honda. My first MotoGP victory was on a Honda, and I started to be involved in motorcycle racing in 88, and then apart the 5 years that we have done with Aprilia, back on the two strokes era, where Honda wasn't really 100% committed in the small categories, we always been with next to Honda. So we personally, I would like to continue with Honda because I feel part of Honda family. I know everybody in Honda, and I know that Honda has the technology and the potential to climb back.
Well, it certainly sounds exciting listening to you talk about the sheer amount of work and investment, not just obviously money and resources, but the time that they're putting in to try and, like you said, climb back to the top where they've been for so long. And I think we'll leave it there on a hopeful good note, looking to the future. Obviously, we very much hope to see Alex back on track soon. Hope that surgery goes okay. And thank you for joining us and talking to us a little bit about how it works from your side and with, yeah.
Pleasure.
We've not spoken to you since COTA, so congratulations on that victory.
Thank you.
And hopefully we'll see many more, and warm-up champion next step, and then a little bit more next year. You need to do the stats again for this season.
Thank you.
Thanks so much, Luke.
Thank you. Really appreciate it. Thank you.
Fanno anche bello.
Ho visto già anche i miei